This is my 35 Ford coupe. I've owned this for about 43 years. We're going to give a demonstration of how the brakes work with the floater kit on. We have to change the wheels again, but this is the inside. I'm just going to show you now how to set up this floater kit in the rear hubs of a Model A, in this case a 34 Ford backing plate, which is near enough the same. One of the critical things that you have to consider in doing a brake job is the centering of the shoes, and normally if you didn't have this brake floater kit, the centering is quite critical. This is normally done by the shoe roller pin resting on this track, which gives it this vertical alignment. Now, because we're fitting this floater kit, we've developed these square pins, and these pins are like a cam, so that when you rotate them to one of the other flat segments, you end up with a slightly higher measurement, which will lift the shoe slightly. Now, normally the measurement here between the spring hanger and the track is 1 inch, and you can see on this how these are worn, a groove in them. This allows the roller to drop into the groove. Now, setting up this kit, you would first, as we've explained previously, is remove the top old adjuster. Now, this is done by screwing it fully in and popping out the little dust cap and replacing it with the new adjuster with the lock nut obviously off. So that goes in first. Then it's followed by the floating wedge. Now that wedge sits vertical like that and goes directly in the hole. Now you would set these pins up on your shoes so you have a gold one on one side and a silver one on the other side. There are a left and a right, so they're a mirror image of each other. And you get two positions from each rotation. So for the third position, the gold one would have to be shifted to the other shoe, and vice versa. So we'll set this up. Roller goes on the pin, and the pin goes into the shoe. Like so. And then you would pin it. Then, after dressing up the track, now the track gets this little groove in it, so you must smooth that out. And you can use a grinder with a reasonably small stone on it, and just use, or a cut-off wheel, and just use the back of it to tidy that up and get it nice and flat. Now if this becomes too thin, then it should have some weld on it, or the track should be completely replaced. But with using these square pins, it gives you a bit of lift in your shoe vertical. So this would go into here, and the shoe sits like that. You can see that that flat sits nicely on the track. Well, in this case, it sits like that. So the same applies for the side. Now for the final adjustment here, you'd rotate this pin while measuring from the axle race, which is normally in the center there. So you measure from there to this tip of the shoe, both sides, and also the other end. So you get that centered in the shoe, or if not slightly this way towards the adjuster, by say about 1/16th cut. Now when you're setting up the measurement of the shoe, this is reasonably important, as if one shoe is sitting slightly further back than the other, you can get a bit of a drag on the brake after braking, and it will not immediately release. So this is reasonably important to set that up so that you have 1/16th slightly higher or towards the adjuster on the square pin. So you rotate the square pin to suit this measurement. We're now setting up the front for the floater kit, and as we've mentioned in the previous video, you remove the top adjuster, which is that there, and also the dust cap, which is that there. Now that is removed by screwing it in and forcing the dust cap out. You also need to remove the anchor bolt and wedge, actuating wedge at the bottom. Now this is done by removing the nut at the back, which we've already done, and so this just comes out. But of course, you've previously removed the springs from here, and it's completely out. Now, the parts that you'll be left over with, because you're replacing them with the floater kit, is you have four items. You have the old anchor bolt, you have the washer, you have the long spring, and you have the top adjuster. So completely those parts will be left over, and they're replaced of course with the new adjuster and floating wedge, new lower anchor bolt, and of course the spring stays off, so you have one spare part there. So this is fitted up with the shoes removed, you fit the top adjuster in the hole and screw that in, but it's advisable to clean up the thread with a tap, because quite often they get rust in the back of them. Certainly if your adjuster is screwed quite a way in, then there's a bit of thread exposed there, and you get a little bit of rust there, so a tap will clean that up. So in goes your new adjuster at the top. Then your floating wedge goes in after that, so, and it goes in there with the narrow side facing out. Now on the bottom, you take the anchor plate or centering plate from the kit. You take your new anchor bolt and you take your existing wedge and you place these three together. So that goes on there, plate goes on there. The plate replaces this washer, so it's discarded, and all three placed back in the hole like that. Then you set up your shoes. Putting up the plate, you turn the nut, tighten the nut up just finger tight while lifting that plate. Then you're set up to put the shoes on. So the shoes can be put on, you hook the spring on onto there, set it up in the roller track. Now of course before the shoe goes on, the track pin must be reversed from the conventional way. Now this only applies to the front brakes, so you would, the head should be facing out, the cotter should be facing in. Now if there's excessive looseness between the cotter and the roller, like in this case, it should be shimmed a bit with a fibre washer or a regular washer, flat washer. So in this case we've got this flat one. Now that is best under the head of the pin. When you put the cotter pin in, ideally you want it, the head facing approximately like, actually like that there, say to the edge of the shoe, so that you've got minimal interference with the old track. And you trim off the legs as well. So that can go in there. Spring. So you can put your spring on like that, hook it into the lower plate, make sure your rollers are sitting nicely over the wedge. There you have it, the completed setup, except for the final adjustment of the lower plate. Now, for the final tightening of the lower plate, to be on the safe side, you should probably use a torque wrench. The main thing there is that you don't pinch the wedge by over tightening that nut at the back. Now, while you do that, the plate needs to be lifted slightly so that it's up near the spring hangers. So you just give that a little bit of encouragement to come up, and you can tighten that up like so, probably to about 10 pounds or something like that initially. And then you check the floating action of the top of the shoes. Now these should float nicely. One shoe should be able to push the other backwards and forwards, as you can see there. It's reasonably important to have a slight bit of gap under the push rod or shoe links, just the links there and there, and so that it's nice and free. Now that's controlled by the plate having a seesaw action, which can lift the one shoe or the other. Now, if you have, or you're fitting brand new drums for a Model A, then your drums should be 11 inches, and your shoes, fully backed off on the adjustment here, should be around 1/16 of an inch under. Now, the brake wedge is all designed as though you've got a brand new setup, shoes, drums, everything. So your starting point is with this fully backed off. You should have about 3/8 of an inch adjustment left on the back. So you should have plenty of adjustment. Now, with some vehicles that have done a high mileage, and we're talking about obviously 80-year-old vehicles here, the bits and pieces that can be reasonably worn. And one of the things that can be worn, which can affect the adjustment or the amount of threads you can end up at the back, and that is these shoe pushrod links. The length of your pin from the inside of the, or the pushrod link from the inside of the pin should be 1 inch and 9/16. Now, because of the nature of the adjuster, you've got these serrated, and this is very good quality steel, good quality Ford steel. You've got these serrations which grind away on the adjuster, so you can end up with these push rod links quite short, and this ultimately will affect how much adjustment you end up with on the back. So the solution is add a little bit of weld, like MIG weld, which is high tensile, onto the end of these shoes. It's not super critical, the measurement, but maybe around 1/8 of an inch would work quite well. This is if your drums are excessively worn or if your shoes are worn. If you're planning on doing a complete brake job and relining your shoes, the best way to go is the bonded linings. Now, there are various types of bonded linings. You can still have the soft linings bonded. Now this compound here is a softer type of lining. It has a small flake of aluminium in it, but these are quite popular for Model A's. These have been lined at 1/4 of an inch, which is about 1/16 of an inch more than what you want. You'll find that if you have new drums and everything's back to specs, these will be, you'll be difficult to get the drum on, so there'd be a bit needs to be shaved off. So you'll need to get these radiused or arced on a radius machine. Now, if you haven't got access to this, a little shade tree mechanic idea is to get them within cooey of, or get them close to the drum size, probably by hand sanding them, or hopefully they'll come out close, and allow a good load of rust to accumulate on your drum, and fit your shoes up, and then on a private driveway do some slow runs with your foot lightly on the brake pedal, and you find that these will help to hone the shoe to match the drum. Just a shade tree mechanic idea. We're dealing here now with fitting the floater kit to a 1935-36 Ford V8. The same thing applies as the Model A's, where you remove the top adjuster. Now, this is screwed fully in until it pops out the dust cap. So in this case, we've pre-done it. You remove that, and of course your springs are removed, take the new adjuster, remove the jam nut from the top, place that in the hole. Now, if there's rust in the thread, you need to run a tap through the thread just to clean it up. So that goes in like so. Then in goes the wedge with the narrow side facing out. You replace the springs, bottom and top. And of course on your rod, pedal rod to your cross shaft, you should drop the link to the lower hole. That is your pedal rod to your cross shaft. That's the rod, the shaft that your brake rods come off. And so this is reasonably simple. You lube this, of course, a little bit in here before it's assembled. Same applies to the 37 to 38 brakes, is the floater at the top is fitted into the hole just as the 35-36 system does. On 37 to 38 they have four springs and they anchor from the shoe to the backing plate. Now these have to be changed as they're all different strengths. So when you add the floater to this vehicle, they must be changed. We supply a single spring in our kit with instructions of how to set the cables up, and so you end up with a good quality brake. This is the AA truck brake. Also, the brake floater kit fits 1932 to 1938. You'll see here in the kit that is the same as the motor vehicle, as the car. It has four floating wedges and four adjusters. Also, a larger anchor pin. These are fitted in just the same as the Model A car, with a floating wedge on top. And on the front brake, only you have the anchor bolt, exactly the same as the car, and the anchor plate the same. Now that anchor plate fits over your lower ankle bolt, just like the car one. This is the heavy duty Model A brake kit. You'll see here the lower plate. This is a 5/16 heavy duty one, and it's fitted up just a little bit different than the standard kit. Take the bottom plate and you have these jam nuts on the back, and they go in there. It's the same as the conventional kit as far as this goes. You take the wedge and it fits over the anchor bolt. Fits through just the same. The top adjuster is set up exactly the same as the standard brake modification, and the top adjuster is removed the same way by screwing this fully in and popping out the dust cap. First, of course, you screw the top adjuster in. This is the offset wedge that goes with this modification. This allows the wedge to sit at the back of the hole. It goes in there like that. And it's set up the same way as the conventional kit, with pins and top. That's the finished assembled article. Don't get this confused with the standard brake modification. One of the first things you do is make sure your foot pedal returns nice and freely. You can try that with all your rods disconnected. It should come back like that.